What just occurred, one that's less hierarchical, and But what's interesting to me is when they printed an LP version of this piece and, you know, sent it out to anybody who was willing to buy it, they also included in it program knobs for the listener. So these are computer-generated random numbers that tell the person at home who's playing the record at what time they should, at what rate, they should turn the knobs on their own record player. Okay? So imagine this scenario, right? Maybe you're sitting at home, as you do, listening to John Cage in your record player, and you're maybe the only person in the room, and you're manipulating the sound via the knobs. In this scenario, who is the performer? Is the performer the one that was recorded originally? Is the performer the one that's manipulating the sound now? And what is the music? Is it the stuff that happened in the room in which the recording happened? Is it the plastic LP? Or is it what's coming out of the speaker? And then an even weirder question is, who is the audience? Especially if it's just one person in a room with one record player. I don't know. So here we have an example of John Cage doing what he does best, which is poking a hole right through the Western classical paradigm, right? He's showing us that the divisions between performer, music, and audience are blurry at best. So I'm going to play Elgar, the beginning. And I want you to see if, while I'm playing, if you can actually manipulate the volume of my playing in your head. One way to think about this that's a little bit easier is sort of zooming in and zooming out on my sound. See if you can do this inside your mind while I play. Visible definitely responding to the music. If performer and audience are responding in exactly the same way to the music at a physical level, what's the difference between the two? And music, is it that thing that's physically being reshaped on screen? That's something that we aren't even able to detect with our own senses. Right? So there's this whole other current of music that exists beyond our ability to see it. I think this is another opportunity to notice that performer, audience, music are really all just perhaps the same thing. So I'm going to play my G string. I just want you to think about the fact that your body is experiencing the G string in exactly the same way that my body is experiencing the G string. Two gateways, one, a little bit of John Cage, two, a little bit of cymatics. The third way is a little bit more mystical. It's a way that was proposed by my teacher out at the Ithaca Center. He talks a lot about the dream state. So I want you to pick a dream that's memorable to you, maybe one that you've had in the last few days, or something that stuck out especially. You can close your eyes if that makes it easier to recall. Just think about this dream for a few seconds. The walls or the landscape surrounding you? Who are you with? What are you doing? I want you to realize that everything that you're seeing through your own perspective in that dream is created by you. And we acknowledge this, that in the dream state, you are creating the entire dream. So go ahead and open your eyes if you haven't already. The process of waking up from the dream is the process of realizing that all of that was just happening inside of you. That's what to be awake is to notice, oh, dreaming was happening inside of me, now I'm in a different reality state. But what if we mapped on the same concept onto reality, right? So here we are from our own vantage point looking at this room. But everything that we see in this room is really just created by our own senses, right? Like, I'm not actually feeling the floor. What I'm feeling is my feet, the nerves in my feet, what they feel on the floor, right? And when I'm looking at the walls of this room, I'm not actually looking at the walls themselves, I'm looking at what my eyeball is producing. Right? When I'm hearing sound, am I hearing the real sound, or am I just hearing what my ears are producing? I'm hearing my ears. So what's happening in a dream state, where you've supplanted yourself as a smaller version inside the dream, and then you perceive everything, could also be happening in the wake state too, right? Everything that I'm perceiving is me. So I'm going to play the piece that you might have had the hardest time to listen to, which is Webern. And I want you to realize that since Webern is happening here, and here is inside of you, here is a production of you, that Webern is also inside of you too. So just use this, the next 20 seconds or so, as an opportunity to study how you were the one creating. audience is someone that's sitting in the seats, or that music is something that's arbitrarily passed between the two. Maybe you've gotten a glimpse that they're all the same thing. Hopefully. So there are a lot of names for this sort of thinking. And sort of our vernacular language, we call it wholeness or oneness. The Greeks used the word enosis, or the blank slate thinking, tabula rasa. In Swahili, they have a word called ubuntu, which means I am because you are, roughly translated. We are together. Often used non-duality, universal love. Shin'ichi Suzuki, who's a Zen teacher who taught in the United States, called it big mind. So when you are in the dream state and you awake to being in the larger state, realizing that you're everything, that's a big mind thinking. Sam Harris, who's sort of a new atheist scientist, neuroscientist, calls this selfless consciousness. So not religious at all, it's just a way of thinking, a selfless consciousness. I'm going to call it, for today's purposes, inside-out thinking. Because if you believe that you are inside of this room, that right now I am standing inside of these walls, and you flip that perspective, and you realize that this entire room, me being in school, this moment of time, is all inside of my own self, inside of my own consciousness, and I think you're thinking sort of inside out. But then the question becomes, why do this work? Like, why think inside out? What's the point of doing this? And to begin to answer that question, I'm going to propose a metaphor. Okay, so if I have two hands that I'm holding out in front of me, and a $100 bill is placed in one of those hands, the other hand might start to get jealous. Right? Why would this hand not be given a $100 bill, but this one was given a $100 bill? Or another example, say that the left hand was thrust into flame. The right hand might hesitate to save that hand because it believes it might be in an unsafe space to also enter the flame too. But what if instead of two hands in front of me, they were just two hands that belonged to a human being, a person, right? One thing. Then when $100 is given to one hand, the other one never questions that it also shares in that wealth, right? Or if one hand is in the flame, the other one would never hesitate to rescue it because we're all part of the same body. I think in this metaphor, you see just how starkly different it would be to identify as a smaller hand or as a larger human being. It's not that jealousy arises and then is neutralized. It's that jealousy never arises. Competition never arises. A sense of scarcity never arises. So imagine, especially for the teachers in the room, a student who used to play rather fluently on the violin with really effortless musicality, who now is crippled by stage fright when they step up on the stage. They're setting themselves up not just as different from the audience, but in opposition to the audience. They see their role as somehow having to try to prove that they belong on the stage. But if they were instead trained to think with an inside-out mindset, that would fall away. Right? If they identified themselves in the audience members, if they identified themselves as being of music or being vessels through which the composer can perform their music, then anxiety is sort of a foregone thought. It doesn't even arise. It doesn't even have to be neutralized. It doesn't arise. This is a Zen haiku poet named Isa. Is not very anxious to bloom my plum tree. I love wondering, like, what is a plum tree? Right? What is a plum tree? Is it part of perhaps all of the plants? Is it a single entity? Is it the leaves and the branches? Is it the circular pattern of, you know, rain, watering, and then growing and producing? Regardless of what the plum tree is, because it's so many things, it's not anxious to bloom. Blooming, it just arises from the plum tree being what a plum tree is. So I believe that Dr. Shin'ichi Suzuki, the Japanese founder of the Suzuki Violin Method, who often quoted Isa and used his haikus, believed that the world was inside out too, or he came to see the world as inside out. Mozart clarinet quintet in person in his 20s when he was in Germany. I just want to read you, this is directed from the book, what he said. I am uncertain as to when I started thinking this way, but I consider myself to have been nurtured by Mozart, and through him to have come to know love, truth, goodness, and beauty that transcends all reasoning. The catalyst for all this was the clarinet quintet performed by the Klingler Quartet. That evening, I was gradually drawn to the depths of Mozart's soul, and before I knew it, I was immersed in the moment that I was oblivious to everything. Indeed, I had even forgotten my own existence. The performance over, I tried to applaud, but I had no hands at my disposal. Numb from my shoulders down, my hands were immobile. Amidst the endless applause of the entire audience, I was in a state of shock. Even when I regained my hands and my senses were eventually restored, I continued to stare vacantly. An outsized, indescribably lofty joy and excitement had carried away my soul. I had been blessed with entry into the world of Mozart's noble soul, and at the moving thought that I had, for the first time, been able to perceive, through sound, the beauty of a magnificently radiant human spirit. I felt as if the very blood coursing through my veins was on fire. That was an infinitely lofty, eternal moment in which humanity transcended humanity. So in that moment, I believe that Suzuki lost all sense of performer as separate from music, as separate from audience. I don't think those distinctions existed for him. I think you also see in his losing his ability to move that he's having a sort of out-of-body experience. He no longer identifies with this skin suit as himself. He's identified himself in some larger entity, in the sound of Mozart, in the spirit of Mozart and his music. So if you think about the cornerstone of Suzuki's philosophy, that every child can because the environment is their teacher. You come to realize that maybe, well, in my opinion, I think he's being quite literal about this. If standing in this room, the room that we are creating is ourselves, then there's no way that I'm not the product of each of you sitting here with me, right? I am the product of my environment. You guys are creating me and I am creating you. So if you surround yourself by wonderful violinists and wonderful violin teachers and beautifully noble human spirits, you will become a wonderful violinist, perhaps a teacher, and certainly will have a beautiful heart. And I think the converse is true too. But he believed so fervently that children were soaking up everything from their environment. And I think this makes sense if he was thinking inside out. Okay? If we think about some of the practical sides of his method, we begin to see an approach to cultivating inside out thinking from the age of zero for his students. Okay, so the first one being standardized repertoire. So every child in the Suzuki method learns a sequential set of repertoire that's 10 books long. Now they might not make it all the way to the end and their teacher might involve supplemental literature on that path. But usually you can bet it, you run into a Suzuki kid that they've played the repertoire in the Suzuki books in a particular order. So, and this is a shameless childhood picture of me. If you're sitting in the audience watching a Suzuki student play on stage, and perhaps you haven't made it to that piece, you're literally witnessing your future, right? Or if you're on stage, or sorry, if you're in the audience looking on stage, and it's someone who's already learned the piece that you've played, you're witnessing your past, right? The music that you know that's so fundamental to you is being performed on stage. How is the performer any different from the audience in that moment? And furthermore, when you're standing up on stage and improve performance, you're looking to your left. You're seeing a student who's going to grow up to be like you, and you're looking to your right, and you're seeing the student that you're going to grow to be. So that's the beauty of the standardized repertoire. I also think that having students learn to automaticity helps them understand the world is inside out. Suzuki would always say that knowledge is not skill. Knowledge plus 10,000 repetitions is skill. And I can tell you, as someone who's done a bow hold, I think, 10,000 times by now, I don't know who's making the bow hold. I think the bow hold kind of makes me. So without thinking, then where is that performance coming from? Is it coming from you? Where is that music coming from? It's almost like it's performing itself through you. Again, not very anxious to bloom my plum tree. The plum tree doesn't think about blooming. It just is. Group performance. Famous examples of the Suzuki Method, which came to the United States, were 400 to 1,000 Japanese children playing on gymnasium floors, playing the Bach double or Vivaldi concertos in unison, perfect unison. Now, when you're standing in a mass of, you know, 1,000 other students, is it possible to really identify yourself as this person right here? You almost have a group amalgamation of who you are and what you're doing, especially when you're performing a piece of standard repertoire and you've learned it to authenticity. Just want to show you a quick video of students playing in action. This is Dr. Suzuki walking in front of them, and he's going to do a little demonstration where he claps, and the music continues in the students' minds, and then when he claps again, they jump back in to where they were. So maybe you would probably already see this. The world. You believe that music could change the world. And if you're the one who's creating the world, if you've come to believe that everything that you see and participate with is also you, then of course you can change the world. And if we have this moment that we're standing in this room together, and you guys understand that I am no different from you, and this music thing is something that is of us and passes beyond us, then we have a moment to break down the divisions between us as individuals, right? Remember that if you're identifying yourself not at the hand level but at the human level, jealousy falls away, competition falls away, anxiety falls away, differentiation falls away, discrimination falls away. And if we can embody that in this moment, there's no telling how far that mind state will pass or will go out into the rest of the world as well. Not very anxious to bloom. I think he saw that when students identified themselves as a greater thing, a participation in a greater life force or an action, that their anxiety fell away and they were able to bloom, that this world just bloomed. If you're thinking inside out. So we're going to turn our chairs back around. I'm going to perform the exact same pieces, but in reverse this time. So I'm going to perform Webern, and then Elgar, and then Corelli. I'm going to play my open strings, and then I'm going to finish with four bell rings. I want you to use this as an opportunity to perform those pieces yourself. I'm not the one on stage. Hopefully, you've begun to see. I'm not the one on the stage. You're the one on the stage. Okay. So I invite you to do that. Thank you.